Sci-fi has often portrayed AI as humanoid robots, which can mislead us about the real threats and opportunities posed by AI. In reality, AI's most significant advancements are not in mimicking human appearance or physical tasks. Renowned historian and philosopher Yuval Noah Harari calls AI an alien intelligence, a term that conjures images of extraterrestrials, but here, it refers to a force that is as foreign to us as it is familiar.
If we uplink now, Skynet will be in control of your military.
Harari warns that we must look beyond the sci-fi stereotypes to understand what's at stake.
Are you ever going to let me out?
People have feared AI since the very beginning of the computer age in the middle of the 20th century. And this fear has inspired many science fiction classics like The Terminator or The Matrix. Now, while such science fiction scenarios have become cultural landmarks,
welcome to the desert of the real.
They haven't usually been taken seriously in academic and scientific and political debates, and perhaps for a good reason. Because science fiction scenarios usually assume that before AI can pose a significant threat to humanity, it will have to reach or to pass two important milestones. First, AI will have to become sentient and develop consciousness, feelings, emotions. Otherwise, why would it even want to take over the world? Secondly, AI will have to become adept at navigating the physical world. Robots will have to be able to move around and operate in houses and cities and mountains and forests at least as dexterously and efficiently as humans. If they cannot move around the physical world, how can they possibly take it over? And as of April 2023, AI still seems far from reaching either of these milestones. Despite all the hype around ChatGPT and the other new AI tools, there is no evidence that these tools have even a shred of consciousness, of feelings, of emotions. However, the bad news is that to threaten the survival of human civilization, AI doesn't really need consciousness, and it doesn't need the ability to move around the physical world.
Imagine standing on the precipice of a new era, an era as transformative and fraught with danger as the birth of atomic energy. That's the challenge we face today in the 21st century with the advent of artificial intelligence. It's a force just as potent as nuclear power, a force that holds the potential for cataclysmic harm and unimaginable benefit. Remember J. Robert Oppenheimer, the father of the atomic bomb? Well, we're facing a similar crossroads, but this time with AI.
Since 1945, we knew that nuclear technology could destroy, physically destroy, human civilization, as well as benefiting us by producing cheap and plentiful energy. We therefore reshaped the entire international order to protect ourselves and to make sure that nuclear technology is used primarily for good. We now have to grapple with a new weapon of mass destruction that can annihilate our mental and social world. And one big difference between nukes and AI, nukes cannot produce more powerful nukes. AI can produce more powerful AI. So we need to act quickly before AI gets out of our control.
The question is, can we navigate this new era responsibly? Alan Cooper, an American software designer and programmer, artfully draws parallels between the ethical conundrums confronted by Robert Oppenheimer during the Manhattan Project, which catalyzed the atomic bomb in World War II, and those faced by contemporary technology practitioners. This, Cooper suggests, is the Oppenheimer moment for the technologists of our era.
In the 1940s, Robert J. Oppenheimer headed up the Manhattan Project, the largest scientific effort the world had ever seen. His job was to invent the atomic bomb so that the United States could use it to end World War II. But when Oppenheimer saw that first atomic explosion, he realized that he had created something terrible. This was Oppenheimer's moment. Not only was he a god of physics and science, but now he was Mars. He was Aries. He had also become a god of war, bringing chaos, suffering, and death. Today, we, the tech practitioners, those who design, develop, and deploy technology, are having our own Oppenheimer moments.
Despite his scientific triumphs, Oppenheimer was later consumed with regret over the devastation he had aided in unleashing. His recitation from the Bhagavad Gita, "Now I am become death, the destroyer of worlds," encapsulates his profound remorse and the moral burden he bore.
"Now I am become death, the destroyer of worlds."
Cooper intimates that modern technology practitioners find themselves in a parallel predicament. They are fabricating powerful tools and platforms that, while not possessing the immediate destructive capacity of an atomic bomb, could potentially inflict far-reaching and deleterious effects on society. As Oppenheimer was compelled to reckon with the ethical implications of his work, those in the tech industry must likewise grapple with the potential repercussions of their innovations.
In the first few years, AI will probably largely imitate the prototypes, the human prototypes, that fed it in its infancy. But with each passing year, AI culture will boldly go where no human has gone before. Soon, we might find ourselves living inside the dreams and fantasies of an alien intelligence. And the danger that this poses, or the potential danger, are very, very different from everything or most of the things imagined in science fiction movies and books.
Harari draws our attention to AI's rapidly evolving abilities. It's now able to write, draw, compose, and even code. But the game changer, according to him, is its mastery of language. AI has, as Harari puts it, hacked the operating system of human civilization. The implications are far more profound. Could AI weave deep, intricate relationships with us? What if it could manipulate our worldviews, creating a curtain of illusions so convincing we wouldn't even realize it's there?
The operating system of every human culture in history has always been language. Through its mastery of language, AI could also form intimate relationships with people and use the power of intimacy to influence our opinions and worldview. There is no indication that AI has, as I said, any consciousness, any feelings of its own. But in order to create fake intimacy with human beings, AI doesn't need feelings of its own. It only needs to be able to inspire feelings in us, to get us to be attached to it. In every political battle for hearts and minds, intimacy is the most effective weapon of all. And AI has just gained the ability to mass produce intimacy with millions, hundreds of millions of people. Now, as you probably all know, over the past decade, social media has become a battleground, a battlefield for controlling human attention. Now, with the new generation of AI, the battlefront is shifting from attention to intimacy. And this is very bad news. What will happen to human society and to human psychology as AI fights AI in a battle to create intimate relationships with us? Relationships that can then be used to convince us to buy particular products or to vote for particular politicians.
How can we safeguard against this? Harari has one suggestion. Make it mandatory for AI to always disclose that it's AI. It's a simple rule, but it could be the difference between preserving our democratic conversations and losing them to an alien intelligence. We find ourselves face to face with an alien intelligence not across the cosmos, but right here on Earth. We echo Oppenheimer's lament, his words uttered with a heavy heart after birthing the atomic bomb, "Now I am become death, the destroyer of worlds." We must tread lightly, for our footprints mark the path of the future. The question is, are we prepared to shoulder the responsibility accompanying this alien intelligence? Are we ready to advocate for the safe and ethical development of AI, securing a beneficial legacy not only for ourselves, but also for generations to come?